We've got three very well-informed speakers here today. We have Dr. Azim Ibrahim, we have Joe Jervis, and we have Jessica Toll. And I'll introduce them a bit more when they each of them come to speak, and we will be taking them in that order. And Dr. Ibrahim has already produced a paper on this. He's the Director of Special Initiatives at the New Lines Institute for Strategy and Policy in Washington, D.C., a research professor at the Strategic Studies Institute at the U.S. Army War College, and a columnist at Foreign Policy magazine. He received his PhD from the University of Cambridge, after which he completed fellowships at the universities of Oxford, Harvard, and Yale. So that must have taken a fair amount of time. But without more ado, we look forward to hearing with him, and then also the views and commentary from our other colleagues. Dr. Ibrahim.
Thank you so much, John, for having me, and thank you so much to my fellow panelists, Jessica and Joe, for being here, and to the Henry Jackson Society for hosting this event. So first of all, let me just start off to explain to you my motivations for doing this report. Many of your viewers will be familiar that I did a similar report on Jeremy Corbyn when he was leader of the opposition in terms of prospective foreign policy of Corbyn and what that would look like when he was in government. So I thought it was prudent to do a similar analysis of the leader of the opposition with Keir Starmer as a potential prime minister, and what his foreign policy would look like if he were to get into number 10. And the principal motivation for doing this, and why I believe it's important now, is that in 2019, Boris Johnson won a whopping majority of 80 seats in Parliament. And this, I believe, was down to two critical factors. First of all, Labour had a very weak and unpopular leader in Jeremy Corbyn, which most people clearly did not want to become Prime Minister, even amongst the Labour ranks. And secondly, Boris Johnson's campaign was almost an extension of the Brexit referendum. His whole Get Brexit Done was a continuation, and it was targeting unfinished business. Labour, on the other hand, were equivocating on Brexit. Boris Johnson targeted a lot of the working class seats in the Red Wall. But it's not necessary in the next election that may remain conservative, that many of those seats will remain conservative. I think it's entirely possible that many of them will revert to the Labour Party. And thus, a Labour majority or even a coalition is very possible in the next election. So I think in such circumstances, it's absolutely vital to try to understand what foreign policy Starmer would have, what kind of foreign policy he would foreign policy doctrine he would adhere to, especially now, you know, the foreign policy is back on the agenda. British people do not tend to vote on foreign policy, but in the last few months, we've seen, you know, what many experts are calling months have happened in days, foreign policy is back on the agenda. And it seems that particularly in a post-Brexit environment, and it seems that much of Keir Starmer, his individual claims and ideas have immense merit. I don't think many people would disagree with him, but his foreign policy perspective, his doctrine is still quite rough and it's less well-informed. And in terms of current events, it is not exactly what it should be. Much of it seems to be driven by opposition politics. And what my paper does is tries to construct what a prospective foreign policy of Keir Starmer will look like. And I did this with very fragmentary information from statements that he's made, from speeches, from his biography. And it seems that he does not have yet a coherent worldview. He does not have a fully formed foreign policy doctrine as yet. And he does not articulate, he does not encapsulate what is necessary for a government in waiting. And this was in contrast, obviously, to Jeremy Corbyn, who had a very, very long career focusing on foreign policy. His worldview was very clear, multiple speeches, multiple rallies, etc. So that was very relatively straightforward to do. Starmer, on the other hand, has not had a long career in foreign policy as a director of public prosecutions, which was his most prominent job before becoming an elected member of parliament. He did not even think about foreign policy, as no thinking of foreign policy was required. I believe in April 2020, Lisa Nandy, as the Shadow Foreign Secretary, tried to put some stuff together to try to create a foreign policy doctrine for the Labour Party, and that was unfinished business. So it seems that much more needs to be done in that. And the next election seems a little bit time away. So there is sufficient amount of time for Labour to actually put together a team and coalition of experts to look at these kinds of questions and put them together. The current government has put together an integrated review. And what I believe the Labour Party needs is to have an equivalent as a shadow government post-Brexit Britain place in the world in light of recent events, and almost like a shadow national security strategy. And the purpose of my paper was not to criticise Labour as such, but essentially to try to identify some of the gaps that exist in Labour's thinking and try to ensure that those gaps are filled and to spur the Labour Party to generate an assertive and active foreign policy with a coherent vision that puts them in the eventuality that they get into government. And I'll just very quickly point out the key findings of the report before I wrap up and let one of your other speakers speak. So essentially, as I indicated, the key findings were that Starmer does not really think much about foreign policy. He doesn't as yet have a foreign policy perspective, a doctrine. There's lots of contradictions in some of the stuff that he says. And then he then proposes action on. Much of his pronouncements are driven, understandably, by opposition politics. His approach seems to be one of legalism, that is process, focusing on process, on formality, which once again, it contradicts some of the other ideas that he has. And there's also a case of what is referred to as strategic silence, essentially saying the right thing, but not proposing any action. And this is proposed to give the impression that Labour will always do the right thing, but without actually proposing any sort of action. So that's the overview of the findings, the main findings of the report. And I will leave it there under your timeline, John, and pass it back to you.
Thank you very much for that early start. One thing I forgot to mention at the start, and it's been put in the chat box, is that if you wish to do a question, can you put that in the Q&A? So when we come to the, after all the other two panelists, we'll then be able to be posing questions to them. Although you did say that not necessarily about yet having a coherent foreign policy. Well, up until a few weeks ago, Germany had a coherent foreign policy, which they had to completely turn on its head. So in a very fluid world, I think there is an awful lot to be argued about, an awful lot to play for in developing that that policy. And it may be that someone who does not come with all those preconceptions, that might be of advantage, although I hope we will come out with some suggestions of where that direction direction should be. And that brings us on to Joe Jervis, as Director of Renaissance, a voter engagement initiative whose first research project made recommendations on how the Labour Party can build and rebuild trust with those voters who shift, especially those who shifted to the Conservatives in 2019. And on foreign policy, as many will know, Joe advised Stephen Kinnock in his role as Shadow Minister for Asia and Pacific from April 2020 to November 21. So we look forward to his insights and his views on this subject.
Thank you, John. And thank you, Azeem, as well. I found it a really interesting paper and an important paper. And I think I'd agree with the key, the main arguments, if you like, that you've made in there. First of all, that Keir is clearly prioritising a real shift away from the policies of Jeremy Corbyn. And secondly, that Keir is clearly committed to international law. That's clearly in his blood, given his background, who he is. And I'd also agree that Keir is, of course, yet to fledge out a foreign policy or a vision or a narrative about Britain's place in the world. And you could argue that's probably true around a range of ideas, not just foreign policy, but a range of topics. Keir is kind of in the day-to-day, but yet to, you know, really flesh out a kind of vision for Britain and for our future. And I think that will come in time. I think the best way to assess and to kind of get inside the world of Keir, if you like, in terms of the challenges he's faced and what he's doing, is to look at those, well, what I see as three major kind of challenges that he had when he came to power. I think the first is around the party and even to restore Labour's credibility, if you like, after the Corbyn years, and including a foreign, a very different foreign policy, as we're saying. And that really kind of nothing but a clear and comprehensive rejection of Corbyn's foreign policy would do in terms of winning back the trust of the British people and getting us to a place where we are in the right area in terms of Britain's role in the world and where we need to go forward. So the first is around changing the party in that sense. The second is the kind of daily grind of politics and winning the kind of airway battles day to day. And I think that focus is something that, well, I think that we're doing a lot better in that over the past 6 months with the cost of living crisis, and obviously we've had Partygate in other areas. But that daily grind, unless there's a big news story around Ukraine, for instance, or whatever it might be, there's not a lot of space in there for foreign policy because Labour as an opposition has a certain amount of time on the airwaves. And we need to make sure that we're hitting the messages, the key messages of the day, whether that's around cost of living, before that it was COVID. So I think there's a real sense there that foreign policy does have a role, but that I think Keir's clearly been prioritising other aspects of politics. And I say that third main challenge is really this vision for Britain, from the economy to public services, from immigration to foreign policy. What does that look like? What is Keir's politics? What is Keirism, if you like? So I think that I would say those are the three challenges. And on those first two, I think he's making a really good hash of it. On that third one, on the vision, I really hope that it comes. I really hope we don't go down this route of just flexibility is good, as John said, but I hope we don't go down the route of kind of strategic ambiguity, because I think that is where the vacuum gets filled by the people, it gets filled by your opponents. That vacuum gets filled by people like you, Azim, with your paper. And I think it's important Keir is able to set out that agenda. But I do have sympathy with the fact that he has been very much in the daily grind in restoring Labour's credibility on the whole. And really positioning us away from Corbynism. So I think that's where we are. But I do think he's made some progress. I really do think in foreign policy he's done some pretty important things. Obviously, this commitment to international law, as you mentioned, commitment to liberal democracy and knowing who our friends are, if you like, who our allies are, and knowing who the threats are. Obviously, Russia and China being kind of top of that list. And also this commitment to universal rights and freedoms. So I think the party's done this really well. I think if you look at what Lisa Nandy's been saying, we were doing a good interview for with the Times. I think it was some last summer. She wrote a really good piece for the Fabians, bringing all this stuff together. But as I say, because Keir's been in the grind of everyday politics, that stuff hasn't really come to the fore. You could say the same about our anti-NATO. Sorry, Corbyn's anti-NATO stance and now Keir's very unshakable commitment to NATO. That's something that John Healey's made really clear. And John Healey's also made clear our commitment to Trident. Of course, again, if that hasn't been central to everything that our politicians and Keir has been saying in the chamber, then that is an issue, because are you getting enough cut through on this stuff? Are these messages coming across? But I do think there's been massive progress in where we are as a party. And I think, as I say, this thing around being alert to the behaviour of authoritarian regimes, namely Russia and China, is something that's come through, for instance, in David Lammy's op-ed for The Guardian in January, and the constant, that was about China, and the constant pushing, if you like, for the Russia report to be released and for those for those recommendations to be acted on. And that was happening a long time before Putin's invasion of Ukraine. So I think we've been doing a lot of stuff in the background in terms of moving Labour to a position where it is ready for government. But of course, as I say, in the foreground, it's a bit of a different story. So in terms of Labour's vision, I think, what we've seen really, the reason this is so important, I think, is what we've seen in our research that we did with Renaissance last summer, is that these Labour to Tory switchers really have lost faith in individual policies. They just see policies as being there to be broken. They don't really believe in what politicians are saying. But when we started telling wider stories around around the country about where Labour could take us, about what was going wrong under the Tories, where we needed to go, that was really giving people, getting people to really listen to us and really gaining their ear, if you like, in terms of getting Labour to be heard again, which wasn't the easiest things in these focus groups that we did. It was very difficult to get anyone to engage with Labour at that point. So but these wider stories, they really did matter. And in terms of foreign policy, I think it's important to tell a wider story about foreign policy because, first of all, it shows that the leader, Keir in this case, is quite big time. You know, he's on top of the major issues. It's not the thing that comes up on the doorstep every day, but it just shows that it gives you that gravitas to be able to show that you're a leader in waiting, that you're a figure on the international stage. So I think that's important from that perspective. Also, as I mentioned earlier, leaving a vacuum is dangerous. But I think it's also important to talk about foreign policy more, where where foreign policy intersects with domestic policy. And that's, I think, the key opportunity for Labour, really. We've seen this happen a few times over the last few years with Brexit, the Ukraine invasion and security threats from Putin. We've also seen it from China's economic dominance growing and it's changing philosophy, if you like, under President Xi, with document number 9 really setting out where he was going to take China, and obviously very, very negative around Western ideals and quite clearly wanted to build China up. And I think this has had a massive effect, really. China's kind of new assertive economic policy has had an effect on our domestic policy with our manufacturing base, with the damage towards our resilience, if you like, as a nation. So I think there's a story to be told there about the need for a Britain that can stand more firmly on its own two feet, and a need to talk about how the Conservatives have not been able to deliver that, with selling off of national assets, the fact that defence contracts are going abroad, the fact that I think something like 57 critical national infrastructure supply chains are now reliant on China. The Chinese state owns 33% of Hinkley Point Power Station. So there's a big story to be told there about building a Britain that can stand more firmly on its own two feet, a manufacturing renaissance, which also tells a story about recognising the global challenges. And I think that's a way in for Keir, if he wants to talk more about foreign policy, more about this kind of age of anxiety, era of insecurity, whatever you want to call it, which is very different to where we were when we were trying to get into power in the 1990s. Where it's basically a free-for-all, you know, unfettered globalisation. We're in a different era now. We're in an era where we need resilience. And I think that, for me, is the story Keir needs to be telling about the world and about Britain, which can really not just appeal to voters, but actually that is where we need to be as a country. Thanks very much. I'll leave it there.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that and broadening that out into a number of areas, and particularly into the area of manufacturing and supply. And interestingly enough, the Defence Committee was across at NATO last week. And supply chain and logistics has become a massive issue within NATO. And also the question about supply chain security, as well as its resilience and the impact of China in that. And I think that's going to underpin the AUKUS discussions as well. Earlier, someone had asked me what this backdrop is, and I just ought to say this is the Black Country flag, which is the boroughs of Sandwell, Dudley, Walsall, and Wolverhampton, and reflecting the Victorian phrase that with all the furnaces and metal bashing shops, that it was black by day with all the soot and smoke, and red by night with all the furnaces. And the chains are for the chainmakers, and it was the women chainmakers strike that founded the Women Workers Union, which subsequently went into the GMB. And indeed, they have a chainmakers festival in Cradley Heath every summer. So and that seamlessly moves on, particularly with her interest in working with parliamentarians on others. On exploitation, moves very much into Jessica's contribution, and also because she's the founder and co-chair of the Labour Foreign Policy Group, as well as fitting in being a Labour councillor in what is now the Labour Majority Group on Westminster, which makes her even more welcome. Jessica.
Thank you so much, John, and thank you to the Henry Jackson Society for inviting me and Dr. Ibrahim for your report. I don't envy the task you just went through to go through Keir Starmer's history and background to come up with an assessment of where he is on foreign policy at the moment. As John said, I am founder and co-chair of the Labour Foreign Policy Group. And for those of you who have read the report, you will know we're not an official policy making body within the Labour Party, but what we do provide is a platform for all of our members who have incredible backgrounds in foreign policies, really deep expertise, and who want to play a part in supporting the party to develop a 21st century appropriate and ready progressive approach to foreign policy. We were founded with the idea of looking at a number of elements of the UK's foreign policy approach, from its strategic relationships, its engagement with multilaterals, looking at the role of non-state actors in developing foreign policy, as well as trying to flesh out what progressive foreign policy means. And while we don't take collective positions on things, there are a number of themes that come out. So I'll talk a little bit about that, where I think some of the particular challenges are for Labour, and reflect a bit on the report. But to start, we made a submission to Wayne David's International Policy Review, I suppose last year now. And one of the top lines that came out is that Labour values, which we don't have to rehash, but that include internationalism and cooperation, should really underpin our foreign policy priorities, putting people first, making support for human rights, democracy globally. While foreign policy needs to be underpinned by these values, it does also have to be flexible enough to respond to evolving priorities and challenges that we see. And the world is very, very different now from when it was during the last Labour government, and some of these things are covered in the report. The world has changed, the threats, the opportunities we face are very different. We also have, I think, a greater understanding of the links between the global and the local, how global events influence really local issues and vice versa, and where some of the solutions sit. And we also have a massively different relationship with the EU now. We did a survey last year of our members to ask them what they thought the biggest threats and opportunities and priorities should be for the Labour Party. And incredibly, climate change came out first in terms of threats and also policy priorities, followed closely by rejoining the EU or re-evaluating or re-assessing our relationship with the EU. So those are things that are sort of forefront in our minds at the minute. Now, historically, I've always thought that Labour has had a particularly difficult relationship with foreign policy, and particularly since the last government. Joe has said it's not a doorstep issue. It's not. It comes up occasionally when there are flashpoints, but obviously the legacy of Iraq, what is called unfettered globalization, has really affected trust of the electorate in the Labour Party. Iraq affected our approach to the Syria conflict. Obviously, on Brexit, I think the Labour Party had a particularly difficult relationship trying to reconcile the views of its two big constituent parts. And for a long time, it's been unfashionable to be pro-European and pro-EU in a lot of circles. I also think at the heart of the Labour movement, there's a tension which we haven't quite reconciled, which is this value of internationalism and support for multilateralism in terms of how we solve problems, how we frame what type of party we are, with a real an element of protectionism and domestic priority that exists within the movement. And those things butt up against each other occasionally. And a lot of our discussions internally about foreign policy are defined by polemics. So there's always the conference motion about Israel-Palestine, about Kashmir, about trade unions in Colombia, things that are some very niche issues, some very big issues, but they are flashpoint issues, I think, rather than looking at the big picture. And then just to end on this part, I think Joe's assessment of the challenges is right that Keir's faced. We've been very domestic focused during COVID. We in opposition have had, and I think made the sensible decision to support government where we can on issues. In particular, one is a new leader who has had to manage the internal machinations of the party changing from quite a difficult time of administration. So when we turn to foreign policy, I increasingly think of foreign policy as a toolkit to deliver a vision. So you start with the questions of how you see Britain. What is your vision for Britain and, by extension, its place in the world? And I think this should be an enduring and positive vision that prioritizes safety and security of the people of Britain, but one that is also self-reflexive. So it acknowledges the past, it acknowledges our present, what things have changed, the limitations to the power we now have in the world, while celebrating the successes and strengths that we have. And as I said at the beginning, being responsive to these issues that crop up and change very quickly in the world. And I think we need clarity on how to use foreign policy to achieve our domestic goals, because increasingly these are inextricably linked to our goals for the world. And being an internationalist is fundamentally not, it means that you don't believe in there being a zero-sum game in the world, but you also have to be alive to the fact that not everybody is playing the same game as you and responsive to that. Once you have answers to those questions, obviously big things, and Joe has tried to set out a bit of a direction there. I think the operational side of it is also massive and not something we talk about very often. So how do you create cross-government links between departments to promote a domestic and a foreign policy agenda? And it's something that I've sort of banged on about for a while, and how you do that. And I think there's probably a lot of thinking to be done there still. On Keir Starmer, I agree with Dr. Ibrahim that I think generally he's in a good place. It's not a radical position, I think, and at the heart of that is that rebuilding trust piece. He definitely, and the team has definitely had the right instincts on Ukraine. And I think because they've been unencumbered by the same conflict of interests that the Conservative Party have, they've actually been able to go further and consistently go further than the Conservatives had on issues like sanctions, refugees. And actually, what I like about what I've seen in the past few months is that there are some really important continuities in Labour's positions on issues. So when I worked as an advisor in 2012, 2013, we were pushing government hard on things like beneficial ownership, on transparency around international financial flows. And that's something that has come back as a very strong message in the Labour approach to the issue. Same on refugees in 2015, I was working with Mary Cray and Yvette Cooper on pushing the government's position on accepting refugees from Syria. So I'm glad that it's still, and this is reflective of Labour values, a very important part. And as Joe said, you know, strength on NATO, strength on Trident, things like that. Keir Starmer also has a really lot of really, really good, knowledgeable people around him. So, you know, David has really proven himself. I think Lisa before him was developing a quite clear narrative on Labour's position. And obviously, we'd like to see that develop further. People like Catherine West and Stephen, who Joe used to work for, are all very knowledgeable on the subjects and the countries that they have been put in charge to develop policy and interact with community stakeholders on. So I think these are all very, very good signs of a leader who is not afraid to delegate either to people with knowledge in the subject areas that make up the shadow cabinet's plethora of responsibilities that they have to cover. But, and I'll end on these things, I would like to see more. And the types of things that I'd like to see more on are, you know, a clear line on the restoration of our soft power around the world, bold thinking on our role in multilateral institutions. A lot of conversations I have come back to the, do we deserve the Security Council seat? And what the future of our interactions in places like the UN look like. And I'm not liking what I'm seeing coming from the government at the moment. I'd like to see some bold thinking on and innovative thinking on how we do development, international development. What does that mean if it's not an independent department? How do we create good oversight on that? How do we create good political engagement in those issues? And I'll end with what does our relationship with the EU look like going forward? Because there's clearly still a strong thread within the party that want a much closer relationship. And a lot of the challenges we see emerging now are not necessarily about COVID or Ukraine, but essentially about the state of our relationship with the EU. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Jessica. You mentioned there about not being happy with some of the things you were seeing the British government undertaking at the UN. Could you just flesh that out slightly?
Yeah, well, so part of the international development strategy has been to roll back multilateral funding in favour of bilateral funding. I think that's a mistake because it's one of those things that undermines our influence in those organisations and actually gives the international community a signal that we're just not really that interested anymore. And I think we have a big job to regain the trust of partners overseas. As a little anecdote, I met a friend who is a Belgium national the other day, and the first thing he said to me is, "I'm sorry, but you know, your clown of a prime minister is not doing you any favours overseas." That is not to say that what Boris Johnson is doing on Ukraine is not important, and he's made a lot of right steps on that. But I think the UK's engagement with its multilateral partners has been really poor comparatively recently.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, just a reminder to the to those who are attending on this that if you click on the Q&A button, that's the way you can put questions in to put to the panel, which I can then put on instantly. As I said, that's meant that another one has come up. But the first question then comes from Alan Mendoza of the Henry Jackson Society. I thought it did. Alan? No? Right, so I'll then move on to...
Excuse me, John, if I may say so, would you mind reading the question to the speakers?
I thought we were going to bring them in, but I'm quite happy to read it.
Thank you.
So Alan Mendoza has said, can the panel identify any particular foreign policy practitioners, school of thought, whose ideas they feel have gained purchase among the current Labour foreign policy leadership? Or is it a more pragmatic set of ideas that characterise current policy? And goes on to say, if the answer is the latter, whose ideas would you like to see being given more airtime? Who wants to step in onto that one first?
Sure, I'm happy to come in on that.
Yep.
I think one of the most comprehensive pieces of work that I've seen, and there's a bit of movement around promoting it, is Labour Together's work on the Labour Covenant. A lot of that work focuses on how you use foreign policy to build and rebuild the trust with the electorate. So I would point people in that direction. Sorry, my dog has just come back into the room. So I think that's probably where you're looking at the moment. And that group is made up of a bunch of academics from King's and Kent and others. And so those are the types of people whose voices appear to be most prominent in the kind of Labour circles thinking at the moment.
I suppose to to take W.C. Fields, you know, don't go on Zoom with dogs or children. It's probably good advice. Either of the other two colleagues want to come in on that? Any particular schools of thought? I mean, most of them are rethinking. Although Henry Kissinger, I notice, is very much back to big power politics and advising Ukraine to cede territory, which is a decision for them rather than actually for him to be prescribing, and may reflect a different world. But at least he does have a view and a schema within that. Are there any schools of thought that you think Labour ought to be particularly looking at?
But I can interject there, John. You know, particular schools of thought, I think, is completely up to Keir Starmer as a leader, and to try to ensure that whatever doctrine or philosophy is adopted is reflective of his values and his belief, rather than trying to ascribe to a particular school of thought and trying to mould that into what he believes. I think one of the fundamental contradictions in the Labour Party, in particular, in terms of the foreign policy, is the fact that they want to follow international law, but also have an ethical foreign policy. Now, these things are not always one and the same thing. International law is not like domestic law, which is very clear cut and is a very clear understanding of where it is and where it stands, and is arbitration in the form of courts and judges. International law many times is simply what the great powers decide it to be, what those in the Security Council decide it to be. And as long as China and Russia have a veto on that international law, then many things will be illegal in international law, but will be the ethical thing to do. So I think what Labour has to do is get away from the semantics that they want to follow international law and be ethical and moral, and articulate much more clearly where would they stand, for example, in a situation like Kosovo, where there was a genocide happening and which was not sanctioned by the Security Council, and so technically against international law, but it was a NATO operation. You know, Starmer himself has said he opposed the Iraq war in 2003 because it wasn't sanctioned by the Security Council. But at the same time, the Attorney General, Lord Goldsmith, gave legal advice saying that it was completely legal. So how would he balance that up in terms of the contradiction between the advice from an Attorney General in the UK domestic law and international law? And Starmer himself said, he opposed the bombing of ISIS in 2015 on legal grounds. So there's considerable contradiction there, and I think much more clear articulation is required in terms of where the Labour Party would stand on many of these things. You know, international law is, I've had lots of dealings with the United Nations, and it's quite dysfunctional in many ways. So if you're relying on the UN to try to come up with a position which you believe will be reflective of your own moral and ethical position, I think you'll be grossly disappointed. And in terms of, I think what Jessica said, I think she made some very salient points. I completely agree with many of her points. I think one of the reasons why the UK and the United States and many other countries are withdrawing from multilateral institutions and focusing much more on bilateral is simply because many of these institutions, particularly within the United Nations apparatus, have succumbed to the influence of the Chinese Communist Party. You look at the UN Human Rights Council, you know, who does it consist of now? And these are the global protectors of human rights. It consists of countries like Russia, Cuba, Venezuela, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, China. And these are the countries that are now decide international human rights. So the UK can continue funding these kinds of institutions, and they have just succumbed to the authority. They've come under the control of these authorities and regimes. So bilateral in many ways is actually much more effective. And we can see that in the AUKUS agreement, which is essentially a bilateral agreement. We can see that in the most recent agreement between when the Prime Minister went to Sweden and offered them security whilst their NATO membership is being considered. That's also a bilateral agreement, not done through NATO or the European Union. So the bilateralism is actually much more effective in this new environment in which China is now creating an alternative international system by which they want to dilute the international rules-based order, that which we have all relied upon. And many of these institutions that we have that were created by the West and the democratic world have now succumbed to influence from Beijing, you know, and these are multitude, the WTO, WHO, Interpol, and the African Union. You know, the Chinese have immense influence on all of these institutions. So why should the Brits, and this is a question I don't know the answer, but why should we continue funding and becoming part of that apparatus and furthering Chinese influence, whereas bilateral is much more effective for our interests?
Well, that brings us very much to then to a question from Josh Arnold Foster, because he says, how do we resolve the differences between those who have advanced globalization as an economic policy and those who have a different view about the security implications of this approach? And specifically, how should this affect a Labour government's approach to China on trade development policy and climate change, another area where there is clearly a major shift already internationally in thinking, but how should Labour respond to that in that new environment? I can bring Dr. Ibrahim in first and then the other two.
Yes, no, and that's a very good question. The question of China, I believe, is the most important question of our time. Much of else of what's happening in Europe and Ukraine and in elsewhere, whether it's the Middle East with ISIS or anything else, I think will come to pass. The great generational battle of our time is going to be the competition with China. And I think that needs much clearer positioning from not just the Labour Party, but I think from everybody involved in this. Lisa Nandy in her 2021 conference speech said that we will stand with the Uyghurs, and this is an absolutely correct policy. You know, my institution itself did the first report on the Uyghur genocide, which was used by the US State Department to come to its own determination of genocide of the Uyghurs. But at the same time, the position of the Starmer administration and Lisa Nandy articulated in the same speech is that she said we will engage with the Chinese government on climate change. Now, you can't necessarily have both of those things at the same time. If you believe the Uyghurs are being persecuted and it's a genocidal campaign, which is, I believe, very firmly, then under the 1948 Genocide Convention, you cannot engage with China in any other bilateral engagement until that genocide is put to an end. So once again, there seems to be a contradiction here which has to be cleared up. And I also believe engaging with China, I should point out, on climate change, I think is a complete waste of time. Chinese should be involved. Climate change affects them more than anybody else, but they've managed to game the system and play the West and trying to get as many concessions out of them as possible on this climate change ruse, which they're trying to position. I believe climate change is one of the biggest threats to the world, and I think it's in China's interest more than any other country to be involved and engage on climate change, and we shouldn't be trying to bribe them in any shape or form to get them on board. Yes, I'll leave out of that.
Jessica, I saw you nodding vigorously at one stage there. Do you want to come in?
Well, I mean, I was just thinking about some of the difficulties with that relationship. And I think, as I said, we have tended to frame how we engage with the Chinese state as there will be times when we have to challenge them, like on the Uyghurs and Hong Kong and Taiwan. There will be times when we have to compete with them. And, you know, that is in supply chains, access to rare metals, even in terms of influence in developing countries around the world and in those relationships. And on things like ideology and systems. And then there will be times when we have to cooperate with them. And I think in one way or another, we will have to have a relationship with China. On trade, it means asking much tougher questions about workers' rights, human rights, the environmental protection standards, etc. And we are in a stronger position if we work with like-minded countries on that. I don't think I share Dr. Ibrahim's assessment that engaging with China on climate change necessarily means bribing them in terms of engagements with them, but I'm not, you know, I'm not in the weeds of these discussions. But I think at this stage, it would be very difficult to cut China out of the global system or our engagements, and I wouldn't advocate for that. but definitely a tougher stance on a lot of things and a bit more of a clever approach. I think what will be really interesting to watch in terms of China is their movements around Taiwan and what that means for us. And that will be a point at which the UK and other like-minded nations will have to make some very difficult decisions about our engagements with China.
Thanks, John. Could I just add to that? I completely agree with what Jess has just said. Our view when I was working with Stephen on the Asia and Pacific brief was that you do have to simultaneously be able to compete, challenge and cooperate with China, but you won't get that cooperation unless you actually start standing up to them. And of course, obviously to stand up to them, you have to have much stronger, as Dr. Ibrahim was saying there, the multilateral institutions are not doing their job. And we do need to look at new ways in which liberal democracies can work together, maybe in smaller groups, maybe bilateral arrangements, in order to be able to compete and challenge China. And I think that's pretty key to being able to, for them to actually take us seriously. Because I think for the last 10 years, we've essentially been rolling over having our tummy tickles under the conservative leadership in terms of the golden era and how those advantages seem to only really flow in one direction. So I think that those relationships between liberal democracies, whether that's a new kind of D10 or D20 or whatever you want to call it, in order to really kind of compete and stand up to China, is absolutely critical, particularly in areas like technology, which China are really getting ahead on. Particularly, I think we need and I think Biden's talked about this, we need some kind of alternative to the Belt and Road Initiative that China are using in order to gain this diplomatic leverage and actually gain this leverage on those multilateral institutions. Because if we don't, if we keep going down this route of cutting aid, it's going to be China that steps in, and it's only going to benefit China. So Jess has done lots of fantastic work around international development. I think on international development, we need to be telling a story which is, yes, obviously we want to alleviate poverty, but also that we want to build relationships with these countries for self-interest, to be frank, enlightened self-interest, in order to prevent China from gaining this kind of economic empire, if you want to call it that. Also to try and do things like reduced refugee crises. We need to basically talk about international development in ways that is going to connect with people back in the UK. And obviously China's a big part of that. Just a final point on kind of inspiration, if you like, from certain thinkers around where Labour's foreign policy needs to be. I quite liked one thing I saw from Robin Niblett at Chatham House around Britain being a global broker and using our soft power to bring countries together and actually see that, as Jess talked about at the beginning, really talk about the need and the importance of British soft power and what that gives us. Obviously, we've seen cuts to the British Council. We've seen a continual bashing of the BBC by the Conservative government. Of course, the only parties that bash the BBC seem to be United Russia, the CCP and the Conservative Party, because we recognise that the BBC is extremely important in terms of soft power around the world and tackling disinformation. So I think there's definitely a piece around soft power there where Britain can have more influence. We also, as I say, going back to this key point that Jess made around the way we approach China and actually having to stand up unified in order to actually get that cooperation that we're going to need in the long run.
Thank you. And then just shifting continents, we get a question from Jeffrey Ben-Nathan. What should be the Labour Party's relationship with America? But that presumably means also what should be a Labour foreign policy and Labour government's relationship with America as well. Who wants to come in on that one first?
So if I may. First of all, I'd like to just say that I completely agree with Joe in his description of soft power and the role it should be playing in Britain's strategic outlook. You know, we are no longer a superpower. We do not have the say. We no longer have an empire, and we shouldn't aspire to be one. And this is where I believe the integrated review was quite good. It was essentially looking at us as a premier middle power, and in terms of how we can utilise our position as a, you know, global problem solver. This is one thing the UK has actually been very, very good at historically as well, is that bringing countries together and trying to solve some of the most intractable problems. And we're actually much better than we give ourselves credit for. During the financial crisis, for example, with Gordon Brown, that brought many of the countries together. And even the White House acknowledged that. You know, I taught at the University of Chicago for a number of years, and amongst the faculty there was Professor Austin Goolsbee, who was the chair of Obama's Council of Economic Advisors. And he told me explicitly, you know, we took the lead from Gordon Brown in terms of bringing the world together. So this is something that we're actually quite good at, and I think a much more emphasis should be placed upon that in terms of our intellectual capacity in tackling some of the long-term problems of the world, you know, climate change, refugees, demographical changes, etc. So in terms of the actual question, the United States, I think this is one of the big vulnerabilities. I personally believe that post-Brexit Britain, our closest relationship is with the United States. You know, we're no longer part of Europe. And I think the particularly the security establishment, I think the Ukraine conflict has now completely exposed Europe in terms of its inadequacies in dealing with the security situation right on its own doorstep. And the UK is now kind of leading the effort in Ukraine, and has been acknowledged by the Ukrainian government, it's been acknowledged by the Americans. And I think our continuous working with the United States should be the absolute centerpiece of post-Brexit global Britain. And I think this is one of the vulnerabilities of Starmer. If I was advising Starmer, I would essentially tell him that, look, there are two major vulnerabilities that you have to tackle before the next election. And one of them is the United States. Starmer is on record saying that in a speech in the Fabian Society in January 2021, that the Prime Minister is out of step with British interests because he's working with Donald Trump, because he's engaging with Donald Trump. Now, in the eventuality that the Democrats lose the next election and either a Trump or a Trumpesque figure makes it into the White House, you know, where would that leave Starmer? Will he be willing to work with such a figure? When he's been on record quite extensively condemning the actions and behaviours of the previous Republican administration. And the second vulnerability I believe he really needs to tackle, which I firmly believe will be weaponized by the Conservative Party come the election, is Starmer serving under a Corbyn government, a Corbyn shadow cabinet. You know, there were many individuals within the Labour Party who did not see fit to serve under Corbyn. They simply could not participate in a Corbyn government, so they resigned from the party. Some of them resigned from the front bench. Many of them left the party and torpedoed their own careers, the likes of Mike Gapes and Luciana Berger and others, where Starmer stayed put. And by serving in a shadow government under Corbyn, irrespective of what he may say or do now, was the fact that he was willing to allow him to become Prime Minister. So I think these are the two vulnerabilities on the foreign policy front, which I think if I were advising Starmer, I would say, like, these are the ones that have to be tackled, and you have to adopt a position now to clarify that. Working on a future Trumpesque administration, working with them, and the fact that you're continuously served under a Corbyn shadow government, despite the fact that the likes of Corbyn and Seamus Milne, you know, if they were in power now, what would have been our position in Ukraine? I would imagine it'd be very different from what we are seeing at the moment.
Thank you. I'm leaning forward, as people I see, but because I'm a bit of difficulty on reception. It's either Joe or Jessica, do you want to come in on what we should be doing in our relationship with the United States?
I'm happy to, if that's right. Jess, that's cool. I think I broadly agree with Dr. Ibrahim. I think the key points for me is that we have to be very clear and, you know, open as a country that the US is our key ally, and we need to be clear when we're, you know, and bold on that when we're dealing with China, you know, whatever situation we're in, we do need to be clear that the US is an ally, and for the reasons politically for Labour that have been just mentioned, that's absolutely key. I think rebuilding that relationship or building a stronger relationship with the US so they're actually listening to us. I'm not sure they've listened to us for a couple of decades if you go back, but actually I think Keir would have an opportunity with Biden, given the mutual respect, I think, to be able to rebuild a bit of trust there. I don't think as much. I don't think Biden's much interested in Boris Johnson. So I think what we saw in Afghanistan was another example of either Boris Johnson didn't try to influence at all, or he just didn't have any influence. I'm not sure which one of those it is, but they both mount to a pretty kind of worrying situation. So I think we do need to be clear on that as a party that the US is our kind of biggest ally, if you like. But I don't think we can't be turning our back on Europe. I think we need to be Keir again is in a good position to rebuild those European alliances. I think John Healey's been very clear that the Tories have taken their eyes off the ball in terms of European security with Russia's invasion, cutting troop numbers, but also sending ships out to the Asia Pacific. There are three pillars here: US, Europe, and Asia Pacific. The Asia Pacific pillar is important, and it is a long-term, you know, thing in terms of a long-term ambition to, I think it should be at least, to engage with countries in that area, given China and the threats there and Taiwan and so on. But I think it's pretty clear that the US should be doing that job. We primarily need to be looking at security in Europe, and then building up from there. So I would say, still very, although I think the US is going to be, is our kind of long-term ally, I think we do need to really be very focused on European security and rebuilding those relationships there. And then in the long term, obviously looking to Asia Pacific.
Okay, Jessica, anything to add?
Yeah, I mean, it's clear that the US is a very important relationship to us historically, culturally, politically, but it's clear that it can occasionally be captured by populist movements and isolationist approaches, and we just need to be alive to that. I think, obviously, it's core to the Euro-Atlantic security establishment. I think it's on many levels, because of a values-based, shared values-based, important. But we also can't be afraid to diverge when necessary from the positions of the United States. So I think where we can probably help each other the most is on building democracy internally and ensuring that neither of us are vulnerable to reproaches from countries like Russia or China on the things that we get wrong internally and can improve on. And I think there's, Joe mentioned D20. I know there was a discussion a while back about a sort of group of democracies. And I think those countries working together to improve their own systems would be a really, really powerful signal globally. I just want to come back on one thing that Dr. Ibrahim said, though, about Keir Starmer's vulnerability having been in the Corbyn cabinet. That's a very Fabian thing to do. You know, working from the inside. So it may well be a vulnerability, but I think he's also insulated himself a bit from it by being the pro-European mouthpiece within the Corbyn cabinet. So he sort of distinguished himself quite a lot from the leadership's policy positioning.
Thank you. Thank you for that. And I think one of the areas which we can go at very strongly is the current British government seems to have ignored many of the very strong signals coming out of Washington about the sort of general values basis of foreign policy. For example, on trade deals, Biden is saying to a point where no one should be any mistake. These are going to be worker-centric trade deals. Both the administration and also Gerry Connolly, as the current president of the NATO Parliamentary Assembly, Democrat congressman, is saying very strongly for NATO's future policy is it's going to be based on democratic values. And I think that this values agenda is one where the government seems to have a tin ear, our current government seems to have a tin ear for this, and one which I think we ought to be developing more. and focusing not just in general terms, but also in practical ways in which we can work with the United States administration in order to pursue that agenda. And in the words of our Defense Committee report on relationship with the US, from the point of view of the UK, I would argue, we argued, is the indispensable ally. And indeed, the whole, at the moment, within discussions within NATO, absolutely key is retaining the US interest, but also the US presence in Europe as well. I'm mindful of the fact that we've now run out of time for this session. There's a couple of questions I'm sorry we didn't get to. But can I thank our panelists for an interesting discussion, and also from the comments coming through from the participants, and obviously to the Henry Jackson Society for organising and hosting this.